Psalm 5:5 is always where I start. Always where I start with the gospel. God hates all who do wickedness. He abhors the wicked man. He abhors the wicked man, okay? In our generation, in our world today, we like to think, oh, God is love. And yes, God is love. But we always like to think that we deserve God's love. That man somehow deserves the love of God. Wrong, we do not. Man is inherently wicked, innately wicked, and totally debased. There's plenty of examples of unregenerate man in the Bible. What happens when we look at Genesis chapter 19? God has sent two angels ahead of him to Sodom and Gomorrah before he comes to destroy the city for its wickedness. Now the men of Sodom and Gomorrah see the angels coming, and the Bible says all the men, great and small, old and young, go to Lot's house to try to rape the angels. Now, long story short, angels strike them with blindness. Now, unregenerate man struck with blindness, what do? They turn from their sin? Do they change their ways? Do they stop going after the angels? No! The Bible says they weary themselves seeking the handle in an attempt to get in. Okay? That's unregenerate man. Genesis chapter 8, every inclination of his heart is wicked in that continually. So what do we do with that? We look at Ezekiel chapter 36. What happens when you believe in God? He takes out your heart of stone and he puts in a heart of flesh and he puts in a new spirit and he puts in his Holy Spirit and he sprinkles you with clean water and he makes you willing to follow his laws. Willing to. But you know what? Even though you're not willing to follow God's laws, you can't do it, man. Nobody can follow the gospel. Nobody. That's why we see in Romans chapter 7, Paul says, me, even a me, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, these are the very things that I do. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Praise be to Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay? That is the key. We cannot do it even though we want to. There is still this body of death, if you will. And the image that Paul is trying to draw here is of, back in the first and second century, when you would murder somebody or kill somebody or cause them to die, a punishment they would give you is they would tie the dead body to you arm to arm and leg to leg. You would walk around with this corpse for a couple of days, and as the maggots came and ate that away, they would eat you while they were at it. And the man you killed would also kill you. Okay? That's the image Paul is drawing from here. We have a body of flesh, a wicked, sinful, fleshly body that is with us until we die and reach glorification in heaven. It's with us, okay? And it's fighting against us. The inner man, the Bible calls it, the believer has, is waging war against the flesh. Okay, that's what it is. You can't do it. Even though once you believe, you can't become sinless. Sinless perfectionism, Pelagianism, the heresy from the 3rd century. None of that, man. It's always Christ and Him crucified. Now you must believe. And the key is, when we look at a verse like John 3:36, what does it say? He who believes in the Son has life. Period. End of the first part of the verse. Second part of the verse. He who does not obey the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abideth upon him. Abides and continues to abide into eternity. There are people in this room, and the very wrath of God of gods is upon you now and has been upon your life since birth. Because of what Adam did. But it doesn't have to be that way anymore. You can be free. You can be blessed. You can be loved by God unconditionally. You can be a child of His. Now listen, you don't do it on your own. Ephesians 1, 4, 5, for He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, okay? And also, I forget which gospel it's in, but it says, none come to the Son unless the Father draws them. The Greek for that word is drag. Some of us are drug kicking and screaming. I know I was. But that's what it is. You cannot believe in God unless God chooses for you to believe in Him. That's the key of the gospel. This is not some free will choice you make to follow God, okay? What does it say? What does it say you have to do to be saved? Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas are in prison singing hymns to God, praising God. There's another sermon in itself. They're in prison praising God with hymns. What happens? Boom! An earthquake comes, shakes the whole place, everybody breaks free, okay? But they don't run. Now the Philippian jailer comes, assuming they've all run away, pulls his sword out to slay himself. And Paul and Silas say, wait, no, brother, we are here. We have not run. So what happens? The jailer leads them out of the jail himself. Now keep in mind, he's been hearing them preach or hearing them sing hymns and things like that. He's got some understanding of God and the doctrine, because Paul, I'm sure, has been preaching about God while he's in the prison, because everywhere he goes, that's all he does is talk about Jesus. How much do you talk about Jesus? Now listen to me. So he comes down and the Philippian jailer leads them out of the jail cell, leads them to freedom, and he says, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? He has just seen the power of God move. And he says, what must I do to be saved? And what's the response? Paul says, oh, okay. Pray this prayer after me. Just raise your hand at just the right time. Okay, I see that hand. Thank you. God bless you. No, that's not what he says. He says, believe. Believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. You and your whole household. That's the key. Why will you not believe and be saved? You don't have to die. I'm not going to die.